Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship service for, pardon me, for Reformation Sunday. And as we come before this event and the marking of this event, we remember the wisdom and the righteousness of God in all of his decrees. And so if you'll stand and join with me, we can read from Romans 11, 33 to 36, which says exactly the same thing. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen.
We come before you with the awareness of your glorious truth that has stood the test of time through your sovereignty, the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, your Son. And we thank you for the heritage. And as we sing these songs of praise to you, we are reminded of the men and women who served you, sometimes even to the very death, that the truth may stand. And we know this is your church. And we know that not even the gates of hell can prevail against it. And so it is with a great sense of reverence and humility, for we know in ourselves we have no strength, but also with a great sense of joy, for there is a Redeemer, there is a Savior, there is one who is worthy to break the seals on the scroll, to declare your sovereign plan, and to demonstrate your love and your mercy, as well as your judgment, O Lord. And so it is with a sense of reverence and a sense of joy that we come before you this day, a day that reminds us that we're a part of the history of your church in the past, in the present, and in the future. And so, Lord, we ask that our worship may reflect the majesty and the glory of your name. May we be reminded of your power in our lives. May we be flooded by the mercy and the love through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would receive all praise and glory. For these things, as we worship you this day, we ask for in Jesus' name, amen. And we may be seated.
Things he hath taught us, great things he hath done. just let me live my life. Let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary.
This morning's scripture reading is from the book of Psalms, Psalm 145. I exalt you, my God the King, and bless your name forever and ever. I will bless you every day. I will praise your name forever and ever. The Lord is great and is highly praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation will declare your works to the next and will proclaim your mighty acts. I will speak of your splendor and glorious majesty and your wondrous works. They will proclaim the power of your awe-inspiring acts, and I will declare your greatness. They will give a testimony of your great goodness and will joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and great in faithful love. The Lord is good to everyone. His compassion rests on all he has made. All you have made will thank you, Lord. The faithful will bless you. They will speak of the glory of your kingdom and will declare your might, informing all the people of your mighty acts and of the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your rule is for all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his actions. The Lord helps all who fall. He raises up all who are oppressed. All eyes look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and faithful in all his acts. The Lord is near all who call out to him and who call out to him with integrity. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry for help and saves them. The Lord guards all those who love him, but he destroys all the wicked. My mouth will declare the Lord's praise. Let every living thing bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen.
What a great psalm of praise, isn't it, that we have before the Lord? Well, welcome. We're glad you could be here today. We're glad for those who are watching by our video and pray that the Lord's blessed you. Today is October 27th, which is Reformation Sunday. It doesn't go on very many calendars. I don't know that there are very many greeting cards or you send out greeting cards wishing everybody Happy Reformation Day, but it is important in the life of God's church. And we mark this day as the time when it was a tipping point between those who were oppressing the truth of God's salvation, met up with those who held true to God's word. The day we mark, as you well know, is within the life of Martin Luther, who wanted to discuss some matters with the Pope and others, some of the false teaching that was going on in the church. And on this day, on Reformation Day, the day before it was actually for Halloween, for All Saints Day coming up, he posted 95 theses. There were just statements of debate topics, put them on the church door. That was not unusual for that time. In our day and age, it would be like saying, we've put them on the bulletin board. This was a place they read them. It wasn't where he put it. It was what was the contained inside of it, and which marked the flashpoint of the Protestant Reformation that we celebrate and that we're a part of, our heritage, our documentation of our church, our confession of faith is based upon the teachings that came out of the Reformation. So we are glad to be able to remind ourselves of the joy that's here. And partly to do that as well is that every Reformation Day, we have a special meeting And it's not just about bringing food to somebody else's church. There's more to it than that. It is about sharing with other believers of like faith. Today, this afternoon, we'll be meeting at Trinity OPC Church, which is just basically around the corner, and it's not very far away. And we'll be meeting with people from churches from the Bay Area, as far south as South San Francisco, from the East Bay, from the North Bay Area, from all over around the county and around the Bay Area to come together. And our guest speaker for this year will be Dr. Strange, who is the temporary or the interim president of Mid-American's Reformed Theological Seminary. And he's going to be doing two different presentations. For those of you who would desire to learn more about Christian life in relationship to nationalism, the idea of where does a Christian fit in to politics and the United States, he'll be giving a lecture at 4 p.m. Discussing that topic. At 5, there'll be a break, and then at 5:30, we'll have our worship service, and that will be a time when we gather together for praise and singing songs and celebrating, and he'll be preaching from Psalm 15 at that time. And then afterward, then we have the food we can eat. So if you brought food and you'd like to have food, we'll take it over there with you. If you would like to bring it, we hope you can bring it and be a part of this time. It's always a special day to gather with friends and people that we have maybe not seen for a while. And so we're going to rejoice together for that. And if you have any questions about how to get there or anything about this, please, I'll be glad to let you know that. Anything about the food and the matters for that, you can talk with Linda, and she'd be glad to help you out with that as well. So we're looking forward to a great event this afternoon and a great time of fellowship and a time to reflect upon what we share in common with our brothers and sisters in this area. That will be today, starting at 4, with the worship service at 5:30. Other announcements are in the bulletin. Please be aware of them. You can begin to start putting together your Operation Christmas Child material. Boxes are available. And did some people take boxes last week? No, okay. All the boxes are gone.
Yeah, I'll have to bring some
more. Okay.
I'll get more offering next week.
Okay, great. But all the boxes are gone. That's good. As long as they come back. Okay. Okay. All right. they do print more. So we will have more. They do make more. If not, you can do what they did originally, and that was to make a shoebox and to fill a shoebox. You can always do that as well. But we'll do that. And so there are a lot of ways to volunteer, to put a pack of box, to help us move boxes, to help us do a variety of things. And we're looking forward to that also. Then we come into the month of November. A couple of things happening in November. We will have Gideon's Sunday, a time when we have the Gideons come and will share with us what's been going on in our county and in the United States, in the world with Gideons. Then we will do the Operation Christmas Child Dedication Sunday. And then we'll do Thanksgiving worship service time, and then we're off into the Advent season, and then we're into the year 2025. So you get your calendars now before it's too late. But start marking. These are going to be very special days and very special Sundays. We want everybody to be a part of them and fellowship together as well. So please be aware of all of these things, and that you might be able to pray for them and then attend them faithfully. This morning, as we come before the Lord in prayer, we want to pray for the service this afternoon, that God would attend to it with his grace and power as people are speaking and as we worship together, that there might be a true spirit of worship and honoring the Lord Jesus Christ. So please keep that in prayer. Also, we want to continue to keep Dean in our prayers, Dean Davis, who is back in the East in Tennessee going through the treatments that we've talked about. Continue to pray for him as he's begun the treatments, that God be gracious to him. We want to pray for Roberta and her life, and pray for her her body would do well. Her spirit is fine. She has had some great, she gets kind of a condensed recap of our Wednesday night Bible studies on Friday. So she's enjoying our Wednesday night Bible study. So we're glad that she can be a part of that as it is. We want to keep others in prayer, especially the children. They're preparing for a special time to lead us in the worship time around Thanksgiving, Christmas time. So we want to keep them in prayer. And then pray also for Harvest Christian School. that God would be gracious and merciful and continue the work. It's been a good year for the students and the staff and everybody, so we want to continue to keep that in prayer as well. So there are many other concerns, other things we need to pray for, other areas of life that maybe are weighing upon your heart. Maybe there's somebody that you know that is just going through a rough time and you just need to pray for them. Or maybe there's a time, an experience, maybe it's somebody that you know that doesn't know Jesus Christ, and you want to maintain and continue to pray for them as well. There may be your own needs that you may want to pray for, or maybe just Thanksgiving. God's given to us so much. There's an overabundance of all that God has blessed us with, and we want to be sure to give thanks to Him for all things. So as we normally do, we're going to take a few moments to quietly pray, to seek the Lord in our prayers, and then I'll lead us in prayer in just a few moments. Let's together, let's go to the Lord in prayer. O gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come into your presence today based on the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ, and it is in His name we pray this prayer today. We come before you to acknowledge your sovereignty. We come before you to acknowledge that you are the one that is over all in this world, over all of the events of humankind, that you are the one that raises up kingdoms and sets down kingdoms. You are the one that sustains and governs and rules, all with the specific purpose for your honor and your glory. And yet, Lord, we also know that you're very close to us, that as we even whisper your name, you hear us. You know our thoughts from afar. You understand our ways. You know exactly what we need as we are in this life, sustained physically, sustained emotionally, sustained spiritually. And we praise you for your faithfulness to us. You are our Father. You are the one that has created us and sustains us. And we praise you for that. And Lord, this morning we have gathered together here with joy in our hearts to worship you, to be reminded of your greatness, to declare the majesty of your glory, to enjoy the fellowship with your people and with you. And so today, O Lord, as we come to you in prayer, we bring before you these concerns that have been on our hearts, areas of concern and matters of faith and life that we bring to you with the joy to know that when we pray, when we draw near to you, you hear us and you draw near to us. And Lord, you know our prayers even before there is a word spoken. You understand our ways even before we walk them. You know the number of our days before there is even one of them. And so our very lives are in your keeping, the beat of our heart, the breath we take, all by your divine grace. Lord, forgive us for the ways in which we have slighted you, ways in which we have forgotten and our trust has faltered, ways in which we have embraced too much still of the world, ways in which we have sinned by omission or commission. So, Lord, we come before you seeking the forgiveness that comes through the merit and the work of Jesus Christ, your Son. To know, Jesus, that what you did for us at the cross was to reconcile us to the Father, was to pay for the rebellion of our sins, and through which we are declared righteous and holy in your sight. We thank you also for sending the Holy Spirit who works in our lives to accomplish great things. And we pray, O Lord, that there would be great things accomplished for your sake, to your glory, within the church, within families, within each individual. For Lord, we live in a time of darkness, a time of struggle, a time when there is much hatred and discord, hostility and division. We pray for peace. We pray for a great awakening. We pray that your will be done. Today, Lord, we pray for the concerns we've mentioned. We pray for our service this afternoon as we gather with the saints from around the Bay Area to worship and honor you, to be reminded of the heritage, to recognize that we are just a small part of a long procession of men and women who have faithfully stood up for the sake of the gospel. For some, there's great revival. For others, there's great martyrdom. And yet they stood strong. Help us, Lord, to stand strong. And help us as we share together with the fellowship today that it would go well. We pray for the speaker that he would be able to be prepared, that you would work through by the Holy Spirit, to be able to for him to speak the words of faith, of encouragement to those of us who attend. And we pray for the fellowship and the time we have together. And then, Lord, we also pray for the other ministries. We pray for the Gideons today. We pray also that you would be with Operation Christmas Child, with Samaritan's Purse, from the aid and the help that they're still providing, even though it's not drawing attention. For we know there are still thousands of people that are homeless because of the hurricanes. There are still people that are suffering and still in need. And we thank you for the Samaritan's Purse and others, O Lord, who faithfully minister both your word and resources to your honor and glory. And then, Lord, we pray that you would be with those within our congregation. We pray for Dean, that you would watch over him. For Roberta, that you would keep her safe and watched over. For others, O Lord, who are not with us today, may your hand of mercy be upon them. Help us, O Lord, as a church to stand strong together, to be the family of God here in this place. And I pray, Lord, that you would also hear our prayers of thanksgiving as we offer great praise to you for everything you have done for us, most of all, for our salvation. May you be blessed. Guide us as we seek to pursue your word this morning. May your word touch our lives by the power of the Holy Spirit, by your grace, and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Son of God is stricken, then see his foe.
mighty rock on which we build. In every line the truth is found, and every page with glory filled.
Through faith alone we come to you. We have no merit we can claim. Sure that your promise is our truth. We place our hope in Jesus' name.
Gloria, Gloria, glory to God alone. Gloria, Gloria, glory to God alone. In Christ alone we're justified. His righteousness is all our plea. The law's demands are satisfied. His perfect work has set us free. Gloria, Gloria, glory to God.
Amen. That was a brand new hymn that we're going to learn. It's a new, not everything came out of the 16th century with regard to the Reformation, but there's new material as well. So children are actively involved with preparing for Thanksgiving and Christmas, and we're glad that we can see so many of them in attendance and working together. Well, today we've come to the final sola in our series of the solas of the Reformation. We've looked at each one of these truths of God, these statements of faith that have been rekindled by the Reformers in a time of great spiritual darkness. These are statements that we have seen as we've gone through them. Believe it or not, this is our fifth Sunday involved with this series. But we've seen these statements of faith. These are the statements that describe the kind of relationship that we have with God. If you want a succinct statement of what they are, these can be used to describe the essence of our relationship with God. These five statements, these five solas, answer the question of salvation. How is it that an unholy sinner can be accepted by a holy God? What makes us acceptable in his sight? And these statements, these solas, become the conviction of all of our lives and the essence of what we stand for, especially the idea that in each one of these, the word, or some form of the word sola exists, means alone, by itself, without anything added to it. And we've seen that it has been the message of the gospel is Scripture alone. The motivation for what causes that is the grace alone. How we receive that, what is the means, is faith alone. And the mediator of this amazing salvation is Christ alone. Many different aspects of all of these, but in reality, to know all four of these and to know all four of these properly lead us to the fifth one, which is really the essence of everything else. If we think of it as a building, we think of the Word of God as being the foundation. Isn't Christ the foundation? Well, in Ephesians, it says that the Word of God, the prophets and the teachers are the foundation. The cornerstone is Christ. But the pillars of grace and faith and Christ stand. But the roof, the thing that overarches all of these, is what we're going to look at today. And that is soli Deo Gloria. Alone to God be the glory. Does that describe your life? You see, for us, this ought to be the very passion of our walk with Jesus Christ. To experience and to see the God in his glory and to live for this passion. This is the full and the final purpose. This is the reason. This is the goal, not only for your salvation, but for your very life. We have seen others who have stated it more succinctly, that we have what is our only hope and what is our only confidence, what is our only faith in life, that we have lived by God, that we are to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. That is our essence. This is the final and the full reason for our salvation. In Ephesians 1, that great passage that talks about the work of the Father to choose and the work of the Son to redeem and the work of the Holy Spirit to quicken, all of them have, in essence, to the praise of the glory of God. The glory of God. There were those in the Bible who experienced something of the glory of God and were never the same. The glory of God is not a tame thing. We've seen Moses experience the glory of God to the point where his face shone, to where people could not even bear the sight of the reflection of the glory of God in his life, and he had to wear a veil over his face. Ezekiel saw this amazing demonstration in chapter 1 of God's glory. Some people have tried to foolishly say, well, that must have been some kind of a UFO or something of that. No, that just pales in insignificance. And he saw this amazing demonstration, which is similar to what John saw in Revelation. And when Ezekiel saw this, which was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord, he fell down like a dead man. Have we ever been so consumed by the glory of God, that it stops us in our tracks? Peter saw that. When Peter saw what Jesus did to bring the fish into the boat, the very next thing that Peter says is, Jesus, get out of my boat. I'm not worthy to have you in the same place where I am. Your glory, your majesty far exceeds what I can even sustain. John saw the glory and fell down, even tempted to worship angels. For the angel had to stop and say, John, don't worship me, worship God. The majesty, the overabundant glory of our Lord. Every major event, every major movement in God's church, every awakening, every revival, every reformation always begins with a deep and powerful awareness of the awesome, utmost majesty and power of the glory of God. Oh, that we might get a glimpse of the glory of God. He becomes more, we become less. This was the conviction of the reformers. Where do you stand? Where do you stand in your relationship to the glory of God as it relates to your day-to-day affairs in life? The struggles that you have, the things that you wrestle with, the concerns you have, the evil that is around us, the fear of the right person or the wrong person might be getting elected, what's going to happen with all retirements and all sorts of things. We worry about it, all sorts of things, to where it distracts us from the passion to be able to pursue the glory of God. Where do we stand? Where is God in the midst of your greatest struggles and the midst of your greatest problems? Tozer said this: the most important thing about you is what comes to your mind when you think about God. The most important thing about you is what comes to your mind when you think about God. Ask the reformers. Ask Calvin and Luther and Zwingli. Ask Lady Jane Grey, those who were martyred for the faith. Ask Spurgeon and Jonathan Edwards. This was their passion. The glory, the honor, the majesty of a God who, through Jesus Christ, is worthy of life worship. What does it mean to encounter the holiness of God, the glory of God? I want us to turn to a passage in the Old Testament. It's one that we're very familiar with, one that we have spoken of. I thought about using the one in Ezekiel, but that was almost too overwhelming for us to look at. But I want us to look at Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 6. This is Isaiah's testimony. Now, Isaiah is not an unbeliever. He is a Christian. He's a servant of God already, a believer in the Lord. He's already ministered in the name of the Lord. But there was just something going on where he needed a fresh awareness of the holiness and a glory of God. And so he writes this under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, beginning with verse 1 of chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." And then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here am I, send me." Very familiar story, a very familiar event in the life of Isaiah, one that others have preached on, was one of R.C. Sproul's favorite texts on the holiness of God. But looking at and catching a glimpse of what it means to have a view of the God that we worship. There is a book called When People Are Big and God Is Small, which defines a lot of people. Our problems, our situations are big, and God becomes less and less. Can God take care of this? Well, I better handle it myself. He may not be able to. This reminds us of a proper perspective of Soli Deo Gloria. This is a fundamental story that is a reminder of a holy God who deserves all glory, all honor, all praise. There's three things that this story shows us here. The first one has to do with the experience of a sovereign God. The experience of a sovereign God. Two things that we see that develop here. One, we see unfolding to us in the first few verses, the first couple of verses, is the presence of God. The presence of God. Now, I think it's important to understand the historical background here. We recognize that from Scripture that this is, we can pinpoint this date to 739 BC. This is a specific time and a specific place. He says, in the year that King Uzziah died. And I think that's significant. People today might say, oh, it was in the year 735. Or 739, and go on. But it is significant to say that it was in the year that King Uzziah died. Now, we know something about King Uzziah. He had reigned for 52 years. Can you imagine a king? Well, we can now, queen in England, but we can imagine somebody reigning and ruling for 52 years. And he was faithful to God. Did right in the sight of God up until the end of his life. He had a grievous sin that marred his reign, yet he still had grace. He was still valued as a great king. He was seen as their deliverer. He was, in essence, the good old days when David was king, when he made Israel great again. And so he had the situation where people adored him and loved him and cared for him. And now in this year, he died. And all hope went with it. What was to be the outcome? What was next? Because if you read in chapter 5, this is a matter of God's impending judgment on the nation. In chapter 5, the Lord gives us this parable, this song that he sings, this dirge that he sings. He says, my beloved planted a vineyard and took care of it and hedged it in and did all of it and cut it and planned it and built a watchtower and looked for the grapes. And there was no grapes coming. And almost here is God saying, in verse 4 of chapter 5, what more was there for me to do for my vineyard that I've not done? In the beginning in verse 5, he tells them of the judgment that was impending, the judgment that was coming. So all of these dark clouds are coming on off the horizon. And now in chapter 6, with the death of a godly king, and so there is a place and a time where there is great shame and mourning and great uncertainty. You ever been there? Time of great uncertainty? What's going to happen tomorrow? What's going to happen next week? What's going to happen next year? What's going to happen in my life? What's going to take place? I don't know how this is all going to work out. This is the mindset that Isaiah had. Where is God? What's next? And what does he do? He goes to the temple. Here is a time of shame and mourning, and yet often in the midst of our greatest human struggles, In the midst of our greatest trials, in the midst of our greatest suffering, God moves us to seek Him. He draws us to Himself. So where does Isaiah go? He goes to the temple. He goes where God is. He goes to God. You see, sometimes God takes away our securities to remind us that He is our security. Sometimes God puts us in difficult places to remind us that He's sovereign over all. Everything for Isaiah, nationally, as well as personally, seems to be unraveling at this point of his life. And he has been now drawn by God, and God makes the first move. I saw the Lord. God appears. In the year that we lost our human king, I saw the real king. And his glory filled the temple. God makes his great dramatic move. God is we talk about the sixth graders wrestling with the concept of God being the uncaused cause and the unmoved mover. God does what he determines to do. He's not affected by anybody else. And we said in our Bible class that if God is moved by something else, then that something else is what we should be worshiping. Because there's one thing, one person that becomes the uncaused cause. And this is God at this point. And he sees the king, and he begins to see this immense, amazing vision or reality of sort of God high on his temple and his throne. And the robe filled his temple. This isn't the first time this happened, by the way. This happened when the glory filled the tabernacle. They couldn't even get into it because the glory had so filled the tabernacle. This happened in Solomon's temple. When Solomon dedicated the temple, the glory of God so filled the temple, they couldn't get in it at that point either. Ezekiel was the same way. Even John, to a degree. So this is not the first time, but for Isaiah, this is the main time for him. And what does he see? What does he see? He sees what God has determined that was going to be the best thing for him. He sees the reaffirmation of the very display of a most glorious, comforting truth that God is still on his throne. Conditions have gone from bad to worse, and yet God is still on his throne, still sovereign. I saw the Lord. Now, can we expect such visions? No, and that's probably a good thing. We couldn't contain such a display like this. But we do have Isaiah's account. And we do have Jesus Christ, God veiled in flesh. So this does not teach us that we're to expect such experiences. We don't expect such power of the glory to so fill a place that we're overwhelmed by it. But we can take this to learn about the nature of God, His sovereignty, His power, a reminder of Soli Deo Gloria and our relationship to this. We have the appearance of God, however, made clear in the presence of Jesus Christ. Turn with me to a couple of passages. Turn with me to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 1. In Hebrews chapter 1, we read the beginning. He says, long ago and at many times, verse 1, and many ways God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, that's the time of Christ on through the end of the ages, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He, that is Jesus, is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. Jesus Christ is the radiance of the glory of God. So whereas Isaiah saw a vision, we see a person. Whereas Isaiah sees a thing in the temple, we see the presence of Jesus Christ in the Word. Turn with me back to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. For God, verse 6, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of what? The glory of God. Where? In the face of Jesus Christ. You want to see the glory of God? Don't go to a temple. Go to the Word. Don't begin sitting back waiting for something to come out of the sky. Read the Word to see Jesus. Jesus is the manifestation of the glory of God. We have something better than Isaiah. We have something far beyond Isaiah. And then turn back over one page to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. In chapter 3, verse 18. And we all, with unveiled face, unlike Moses, who had to have his face veiled, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So it's very clear that what we see in Isaiah chapter 6 for Isaiah becomes a testimony for us in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And when we see life getting the best of us, and when we see struggles taking place, and when we have somehow shifted our view and the passion from the glory of God, there is where it gets rekindled by going back and seeing Jesus. Spending time with Christ. And this is what Isaiah, let's go back to chapter 6 of Isaiah. And this is what Isaiah saw. He says three things about this. I saw the Lord. First, he says, sitting upon a throne. Oh, this is a good truth to remember, isn't it? Christ is on his throne. Jesus is king. The word throne here is synonymous for kingship. Jesus Christ is still on the throne. He is still in charge. He still hears and answers prayers. He's still there. Isaiah saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up. The sovereignty of God, taking care of your life. He's watching out for you. It isn't that he says, I hope you make it. I'll be at the other end waiting for you. Get through there the best you can. No, he's there with us, guarding and guiding and ordaining our steps with confidence and assurance. This is what Isaiah needed. He needed to see that there's something bigger than his problems. He needed to see there was something bigger than the condition of his life. He needed to see the Lord. And he saw him high and sitting upon the throne. And it says, secondly, as the train of his robe filled the temple. The train. Have you ever been to a wedding where a bride has a train? In fact, when I guess Diana got married, there were little kids carrying the back of that train. There was this long, long robe that extended out and filled the temple. and the train of his robe filled the temple. This robe, this train, that indicates his majesty, his magnificence, his glory. That's what we want to pay attention. We want to figure, okay, what color was it? How did it look? What were the roll folds? Was it made? What was it made out of? We want to know all these conditions, all of these things. But we're missing the heart of what it's saying here. When he's talking about the train of his robe, it talks about his majesty. It is a reminder that he is majestic. He is magnificent. God is glorious. And this is the display that he saw, high and lifted up above everything else, above all. The appearance, the presence of God. The very next thing we see, not only in this experience of sovereign God, he also experienced now the praise to God. He saw the presence of God. Now he's experiencing the praise to God. Because around God's throne, so you get this picture, here is the Lord high and lifted up, the train of his robe filling the temple. The smoke is what the others had the experience of, this majesty, this awesome awareness of the power of God. A reminder that God is in charge. So whether King Uzziah lives or dies does not affect God's plans. Two things that God has never said is, one is, oops, and the other is, oh no. God never says those things. And Isaiah needed to be reminded of that with this powerful demonstration. And we need to be reminded of that by looking at the face of Jesus. And so we see there's great praise that comes about. Because around this throne, Isaiah sees seraphim, which are a type of angel. It is a special, glorious class of angels, mentioned only by name and other places as well, with six wings. They had six wings. Now, we don't want to get too detailed about this, but with the two of them, they covered their face, indicating that God is too glorious for them even to see with unveiled face. Aren't you thankful that God has prepared us through Jesus Christ to see him as he is? We will not need to see him through covered face. We see him as he is. And so with two, they covered his face. And with two, they covered their feet. A sense of humility, a sense of recognition. Remember when Moses saw the burning bush, the first thing God said was, take off your shoes, you're standing on holy ground. Sometimes people have houses where they tell you to take off their shoes as you go into their house. That has to do with dirt and hygiene. I don't think there's some spiritual lesson about that. But here, take off your shoes, and the feet are covered, had to do with God's great, our humility before God. And then with two, they fly, a burning zeal to do God's bidding. And what do they do for his bidding? They worship. They cry out. They call out. An antiphonal thing. Some over here, some over here, some behind, some in front. They're calling out in this great antiphonal music anthem. And what is the theme of their anthem? Holy. God is holy. In fact, he says it three times. He says that God is holy, holy, holy. The essence of his glory. Now, he doesn't say that he is love, love, love. Never says he's mercy, mercy, mercy. But he does say that he is holy, holy, holy. His divine perfections, holiness. 1 Samuel 2:2 says, there is none holy like the Lord. There is none beside him. Isaiah 40:25 says, to whom will you compare me? That I should be like him, says the Holy One. Hosea 11:9 says, I am God, not man, the Holy One in your midst. And this is where the Lord takes us, to his holiness. He is incomparable. His holiness, which is the essence of his glory, to be the holy other, to be set apart, perfect in all that he does, everything that he accomplishes. A sense of holiness. defines the glory of God. His holiness determines all that he is and all that he does. He is holy, one of the chief characteristic traits of God. He is not capricious. He does not change. He does not say one thing and then does not follow through with it. He does not can't do some things and can do some things. He is the God that can do all things. You say, well, why can't he do all things for me? I've got a list. Just half that list to be fine if you could even do that. And when that doesn't happen, we begin to question God's power, God's authority, and even God's holiness. And yet God is perfect in all his ways. And he does answer prayer. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. And oftentimes when it's a no answer, we see later on that was the right answer. Of course it was. He's God. But the whole notion of worshiping and reflecting upon his holiness, that was the theme. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. That was their message. Now we know that the angels that appeared to the shepherd had a different, shepherds had a different message. But this one group of angels, the seraphim, had this one message, holiness. And not only that, but when they were singing this, and when they were describing, when they were trying to put into words something that cannot be fully described, it was so overwhelming, the Bible tells us in verse 4, that even the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called. Even the building had greater reaction than most people do toward the holiness of God. It trembled. We read even in the New Testament, even the demons believe in God and tremble. And yet our society and people around us care little for God, if at all. The holiness of God, the glory of God, is so missing in our society. And when that happens, we wind up like Isaiah, who discovers he has a problem. That leads us to the second, and that is the encounter by a redeeming God. You see, Isaiah was in the temple and saw this great throne and saw the Lord in some fashion seated on this throne. The train filled the temple. The seraphim were all around singing. And as Isaiah was taking this in, he only had one thought on his mind. How did he react? Well, he didn't react by saying, well, this is great. This is amazing. Man, I'm taking this on the road. I'm coming back. I'm writing a book about this. I'm going to make a lot of money on a preaching circuit telling everybody about what I saw. Wow, this is incredible. He didn't say that at all, did he? He didn't say, wow, I'm blessed. I'm better than everybody else around me. I saw something nobody else saw. Didn't say that at all, did he? What did he say? He used a word that describes the total undoing of a person. Woe is me. Don't think that he said kind of casually, woe is me. That woe is emphasized. It says, I am in great danger. I am in great trouble. I am in great deep problems here. Woe is me. I am undone. Some translations say. It used to be when I was a kid, we had a toy that was a plastic toy, but it was had a base and it had a little figurine on it. And it was all wired together by string. And when you push the bottom of the base, the string then released the tension and the whole thing collapsed. And then we let it go and put it back up again. Well, that was Isaiah. Somebody pushed the bottom of his pedestal and he collapsed. He collapsed. In the presence of Almighty God, he realized he had a problem, and that problem was he was a wicked sinner. He says, woe is me. The whole place is powerful. The demonstration of the robe of the temple and the smoke is filling this. This is the majestic. No one has seen this for hundreds of years, this great demonstration of God's glory. And rather than saying, wow, it's about time, God, you showed up, he says, I'm undone. I'm lost. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwelt in the midst of people of unclean lips. And in this condition, my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. I wasn't prepared. I wasn't ready. I was undone, and my eyes have seen God, and he's seen me in my condition. And the problem was that Isaiah felt the burden of his own humanity and his own sinfulness and his own prone nature to want to sin. And I think that's important for us to recognize. Because when we see something of the glory of God's holiness, we then see how unholy we really are. Isaiah even probably thought that his life was doing okay until he saw the Lord in his glory. Now remember, this is not the story of a conversion like Paul. This is the call of God upon his life. And the first thing that God did was to make him aware of his own shortcomings. Until we see God in his glory and are confronted with our own condition before him, we will most likely remain haughty and proud until he invades our lives and we come face to face with him for who he is and who we are. And what that produces is humility and confession. We think we're pretty good people. And we've always got somebody that's worse than us, our neighbor, someone else in our family, somebody else. Oh, I'm not as bad as that person is. When you say something like that, you fixed your eyes on the wrong standard. The glory of God is where we fix our eyes. And when Isaiah did that, notice his confession. I have seen, because I have seen the Lord, now I see. His despair, his awareness of guilt, the reason for his woe is me, unclean lips. It is interesting that a prophet would say, I have unclean lips. He was the spokesman. He was the mouth. He was the lips of God already. And yet when he encounters God, what he says is, I've got unclean lips. Beloved, nobody can stand in the presence of such a God without becoming profoundly and devastatingly aware of their own wretchedness and sinfulness. And it is at this very point we see the glory of God in his kindness, forgiveness, and power. You see, to demonstrate to see the God's glory, he needed to see his sovereignty. But the second thing now he needed to see was his salvation. And so although Isaiah had a problem before God, there is the second part of this encounter was the provision by God. You know where it is when you get to a point when you know that you've been purged of your sins, when you've been forgiven of your sins? The Bible tells us it becomes from a broken and a contrite heart in the face of the glory of God. There's no cheap grace here. There's no easy believism. There is pain involved in the restoration. Isn't it amazing that the work of redemption for Isaiah took place, and something probably left a lasting impression on him. The seraphim had in his hand coal, a burning ember, that he had taken with tongs, interestingly enough, and placed in his hand. And he took it over to Isaiah. And he took it to probably one of the most sensitive parts of our body. And he touched, Isaiah says, he touched my mouth. Kind of a searing effect, a noise, a burning, a pain. And the seraphim said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away. Your sin is atoned for. When we trust and know the forgiveness of God, it may have an impact in our lives. Because the things that we once loved are the things that now have become detestable to us. The things that we once embraced have now been burned away. Our desires and passions for lust and for sin and unrighteousness have been replaced now with a desire to serve humbly, to serve and to seek after the glory of God. Here is the provision of God. His iniquity was taken away and his sin was purged. Oh, that we have that in Jesus Christ. We have that awareness of what he did for us on the cross. That is the recognition and the place of seeing the glory of God. You see the glory of God and his sovereignty on a throne high and lifted up. You see God in his sacrifice. The glory of God, of Jesus on the cross, dying for our sins. There is the glory. For in that act, our sins are forgiven. In that work of Jesus Christ, who took our burden, who took our punishment, who took our pain, now has forgiven. Oh, we look at the cross and we see not a martyr's death, obviously, but do you see the glory of Christ at the cross? Soli Deo Gloria. From beginning to end, it is to the glory of God. And now he has been forgiven. And now his sins have been atoned for. Thank God that the Lord does not just point out our sins. People do that all the time, don't they? They're very quick to point out our sins. Not only does he point them out to us, he also provides the means for our cleansing. With Isaiah, it was the angel with a live coal from the altar. With us, it is the precious blood of Jesus Christ. To see his glory in what he's done for you. As Isaiah saw the glory of the God who provides and forgives. After seeing all of this, in verse 8, now we get to the final part of this. And we have seen now, first of all, the experience of a sovereign God. Now we see the encounter by a redeeming God. And now verse 8 begins, we see the exhortation by a commissioning God. Now in verse 8, we hear God speak for the first time in this vision. And Isaiah puts it this way, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Here is the call to serve. Here is the response to the glory of God. Notice that the first words of God are a call to serve. It's amazing that God in his sovereignty has ordained to use the foolishness of man to accomplish his purpose to the glory of God. Someone said that he can even use a crooked stick to draw a straight line. And that's what God does with us. Therefore, you need to see your life as you see the glory of God, as you see, as you declare soli Deo Gloria, that what comes next is, are you living for the passion of that glory? Do you live for his glory? Do you live to promote him in all that you do? Even in the little things. Famous composer, Johann Sebastian Bach. Great composer. A family of composers. Every time, every music he wrote, regardless of what it was for, he would always put at the very bottom of this, S-D-G. By now, you should know what that means, right? Soli Deo Gloria. Everything he did had the mark of his passion. Does the passion for the glory of God mark your life by your faithfulness to him, by your allegiance to him, by answering the call upon your life to be and to do whatever it is God has set you out to do? When God called Isaiah to do this, there is the calling to serve. Response with that was in verse 8, now that he had seen the majesty of God's sovereignty, he had experienced the saving power of a redeeming God. Now he raises his hand and says, here am I, send me. There's no question now his life devoted to the sovereignty of God, to serving the Lord, to living for a passion for his glory. You see, when you experience God in his full glory, when you see Jesus Christ, you will never be the same person. Your life will be transformed. Isaiah said, here am I, send me. And nowhere in the scripture, in verse 9, does he add, oh, and by the way, what's in it for me? Nor does he say, here am I, send me, but what's going to happen? Tell me the consequences. Tell me what is going to happen to me, and then I'll tell you if I'm going to serve you or not. Oh, how we have turned all things around. He had the commitment to serve, learning to live by conviction and not consequences. Because what will cost him will be his ministry. That may or may not be in our case, but for him it was. What was the ministry? What was the calling? God's, who's going to go for me? Isaiah says, here am I. And God says, okay, I'm going to send you. But I'm going to send you to be a prophet that nobody hears. I'm going to send you to speak the word of God to no one who cares, to everyone who does not care. In fact, verse 10, make the heart of the people dull, make their eyes heavy, and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and be turned and be healed. Isaiah, I'm going to use you as a hardening agent for my people. You've got this glorious message of redemption and forgiveness in God, the glory of God, and you're going to speak to a people of deaf ears. They're not going to appreciate your message. Ever been there? We all are, aren't we? We live in Sonoma County or Marin County or California or the United States. The message is not popular. And in verse 11, Isaiah says, oh, wait, I changed my mind. Oh, wait, I didn't expect this, Lord. No, he didn't say that. All he said was, how long? How long? I get it. This is my message. This is my calling. This is what you want me to do. How long? In verse 11, God tells him, he's using him to remove people to faraway places in judgment. Today, maybe he's saying, Isaiah, you're going to preach in the way when you're successful is when nobody comes to your church, when nobody hears the message. Because along with the message of forgiveness and kindness and Christ's redemption, there is also a message of judgment, a message of doom and certainty for those who will not respond in faith to Christ. And that's a message that needs to be heard, because that also is part of the glory of God. And Isaiah said, "How long, Lord? I'll do it." Isaiah saw the sovereignty of God. Isaiah saw the Savior in his glory. And Isaiah saw the God who calls and equips to do his work. All of God, from beginning to end. Oh, that would be our passion. The Reformers lived and died soli Deo Gloria. And yet now they're in glory, seeing the God of glory. And with faces unveiled, capturing the fullness of his majesty. Oh, that we might be modern day Reformers with a passion for the glory of God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your incredible mercy toward us. As we see this story of Isaiah, that we see your work in his life is what you have done in our life through Jesus Christ. And I pray that we might live with a passion for your glory, and that we might live our lives with the understanding that from salvation, from beginning to end, from our life, from beginning to end, that we are called to bring glory to your name and to promote your love, your glory, your holiness. Oh, Lord, here we are. Send us. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll stand as we sing our last hymn. For that.
How great thou art, how great thou art.
Lord, we thank you for your presence with us. The glorious God of the universe is with us, will never leave us and never forsake us. We thank you for our salvation in Christ. We thank you for the indwelling Holy Spirit. And pray as we leave from this place that we'll leave with a renewed and increased passion for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.